The Great Distraction. Before I got sick, I found myself trying to do everything at once. In my case, this meant trying to build a successful career as a sales manager, while simultaneously planning my next trip to the other side of the world. Now, of course, I also couldn't miss out on attempting to physically look as good as I possibly could. So every night, 5 days a week, at 9 p.m., I would clock in at the gym. Most workdays, I wouldn't leave the office before 7:30 p.m. And in the mornings, I would start around 8:30 a.m. There were very few moments for me to actually truly reflect on what the hell I was doing. I developed a routine that kept me moving at all times, remaining in perpetual motion, jumping from one caffeine cliff to another. You stop moving, you die. And it is precisely that exact simple principle, that one absolute ground rule, which the structures of our lives are built upon. Now, by no means is this coincidental, guys. It is all part of what I like to call the great distraction that we have grown to call a normal life. So simple, yet so efficient. It's hard to think when you're on a roller coaster. To implement change, you first have to realize that change is needed. Now, funny enough, most people do know in the back of their mind that change is necessary. Just think of those nights when you and your best friends had a little bit too much to drink, and all of a sudden, you seem to see things so clear, so lucid. The conversation goes as follows. We should just do it, guys. We should move to Thailand and open up a hostel. We've got enough savings to last us at least 10 months over there without any income. Worst case scenario, we just come back here. Cheers! Only to wake up the following day with a mild hangover, hoping that the other person won't actually follow up on your midnight hour plan because you, my friend, had a baby shower in the afternoon to attend. And don't forget, you still need to finish that presentation for work by Monday. You'll think about the Thailand plan some other time, right? Time and the lack thereof are the number one reason people struggle to pinpoint the exact area to implement actual change. Now, this comes as no surprise, as this process requires a lot of thought and a lot of introspection. Most people simply do not have the time they would need for this. That's because the entire system that we operate in is designed to always have you looking ahead to the next phase of our lives. We are consistently looking forward to what is next, not once lowering the pace to actually stop and think if we are heading in the right direction. Now, a counter-argument to this notion would be, well, that's actually what college is for. 4 years for you to study, mature, and figure out which direction that you want to go as an adult. So let's take a deeper look at the concept of college or university. Until the very moment of graduating high school, most teens will have spent their entire lives living under their parents' roof, abiding by their parents' rules. Now, what do you think happens when you take an 18-year-old who has just entered their prime years of hormonal rage after having spent their entire life up until that point in parental captivity? And then you go ahead and give them access to unlimited freedom. Now, you probably already guessed it, as you did exactly what I'm talking about right now. The things that you are expected to do when you go to college. Spending the majority of your time and energy on trying to find suitable partners to have sex with and party, while of course simultaneously trying to pass your courses so that you're still allowed by the system and your parents, of course, to remain in the realm of college. The kingdom of doing whatever you were never allowed to do. Now, guys, look, I'm not judging. This type of behavior makes perfect sense and it should never be judged or frowned upon. It is a perfect storm of hormones reaching the absolute peak of their powers and the world of adulthood being unlocked at the exact same time, simultaneously. Now, the only problem with this is that college is supposed to be the time in one's life when one can actually take the time to figure out who they are and what they want to do in life. Now, unfortunately, because of what I just said, very few people actually really find out who they are in college. Like, how could you? Your internal thoughts and emotions are taken once again on a constant roller coaster of dopamine in the form of new people and new experiences. On top of that, most of your life energy is spent on recovery from hangovers, breakups, missed deadlines, and studying for the next upcoming exam. How could one ever take a minute to stop and think in this vortex of energy? It's damn near impossible. There is just too much clutter. The outside noise is too loud. Because it is, most people graduate college without a single clue about who they are, who they want to be, or where they want to go in life. I believe it's at this exact moment that people should have the courage to take real time for themselves to figure out their next move, instead of blindly jumping into a career dictated by the piece of paper they just obtained. It's not until you're able to see and understand the repetitive nature of mindless partying and hooking up that you're able to take the energy and time previously used to fuel those desires and then assign them to genuine introspection and self-exploration. In most people's cases, this time for honest reflection and self-exploration will never come. Let's be honest, their lives have become completely intertwined with the global rat race as they run to reach the next general objective of making babies and continuing the trend of raising them precisely the way they were raised themselves. The main issue here is that this race is no longer exclusive to adults only. Over the past few decades, it has gradually started to include people from an increasingly younger age. What used to take place around the age of 18 is now starting years earlier, because that's what happens when you put the supercomputer sponges that are young human brains and the availability of all possible information in the entire history of our human species in the same spot. Simply put, the internet and smartphones have changed the whole game in a way that is impossible for us to even grasp at this point. I am very far from being a scientist, but I would be so incredibly interested in seeing a graph that displays the correlation between the rise of social media and the number of people under the age of 25 making traveling their main priority in life. The concept of exploring the world and traveling to remote places has never been more glorified than in today's climate. Social media is applying constant pressure in the form of travel content. The message is clear. When you are young, you have to travel. It will supposedly broaden your horizon. It will make you understand the world. It will literally make you a better person. It will enrich you in ways that you can't even imagine. Look, I don't want to be a hypocrite. I don't necessarily disagree with these sentiments, but still, there is something to be said about this trend of young teenagers already being pushed in a very specific direction from a very young age. The different stages of our lives are predefined in front of our very eyes. First comes the travel content. Typical pictures of Machu Picchu and other wonders of the world. Then comes the build your own business and become a CEO content. The typical young, sleek adult in a suit, closing a business deal on his iPhone while leaning on the hood of the sports car. Once the launch of your own genius app, preferably presented as the Uber of insert random service, backfires, and the inevitable burnout occurs, Bring on the spiritual rebirth content. Right on cue. Guys, my point is, social media dictates how we are supposed to live our lives. It starts with unrealistic travel propaganda that convinces you that if you just visit enough foreign countries, you will find happiness and enlightenment at the end of the rainbow. Now, in my years of backpacking, I did indeed found some culture. But you know what I found more of? Confused fellow backpackers who didn't really know why they were there in the first place. All they knew is that they were doing the right thing by coming to a second or third world country. It's no surprise that they felt that way. I am unable to come up with a single something for which it is easier to receive validation than the action of traveling. The old "I'm going to travel" card trumps all. It is the single most beautiful way to waste your time on this planet, and I have done it myself over and over again. Anywhere but home. Now here is how it actually goes down. Upon arrival in your first hostel, you are instantly submerged in a lifestyle of around-the-clock party opportunity, daily cultural excursions, and constant introductions to equally overexcited young people all in their physical primes. Most of them single and ready to mingle. Let's be honest. The minute you begin your backpack journey, you're basically embarking on a never-ending dopamine cruise surrounded by people coming from the exact same cultural background. The very same culture that you swore to break free from. Your independently produced backpack movie starring yourself is being filmed in an incredible decor of palm trees, blue skies, and poorly maintained roads. Even though the local bartenders know how to say "how are you" in 9 different languages, it still feels more than authentic enough. Just don't mind the Australian DJ, alright? Now, it might sound as if I'm trying to discourage you from traveling and going out in the world, but that's actually not what I'm aiming for at all here. I am simply trying to point out just how much we are constantly being pushed into specific directions. That's it, guys. Food for thought. Appreciate you watching. Don't forget to hit the thumbs up. Leave a comment, even if you don't want to comment. It helps out my videos. Subscribe to the channel, and better yet, share this video. Let's get the word out. It is hot as hell in Belgium right now. I'm sweating like a pig, so I hope you appreciated the video. I'll be back with more philosophy soon. Thank you for watching. It's your boy Wounded Viking, checking out.
Hi, my name's Spencer. I'm a filmmaker from Chicago. I'm a person who struggled with anxiety, OCD, and mild depression for most of my life. I've seen many therapists and tried many different medications. Recently, I was kind of looking for something more, to get more motivated, to get more things done, and I had just come across Lorenza's YouTube channel. I just started binge watching. And I became so inspired about his attitude, the way he goes about things, and he just seems so genuine, so intelligent, and I just decided to reach out because I thought if he could make it through everything that he had made it through and be succeeding so well now, that he must know something. And I can safely say he does. He's so much different than any other therapist I had seen before. I felt like a more of a connection. I felt that everything that he was talking about with me was from experience that he had and not just something that he learned in a book. And I think that's the biggest difference that I could honestly say. So he's helped me so much with motivation, organizing my life, more confidence, and the biggest thing is to live in the moment. And I really appreciate what I have and who I'm with and what I'm doing when I'm doing it. And that was something I've never done before. So once again, I would like to highly recommend Lorenz, aka Wounded Viking. Please hit him up for life coaching.